You want to test one more time?
Yep, good deal.
Okay. You ready?
Yep.
You going?
Jump for it.
We're on the air. What was that?
The solid rock when we went to Yosemite.
Ah.
Talk about solid rock.
El Capitan.
Actually, the one of the of the videos that I looked at for that had a lot of solid rocks. I think El Capitan was one of them. I chose another one because I think, well, the presentation was a little more balanced. But that one actually, the one that showed all the solid rocks, also showed floods where houses are starting to drift away. And that's pretty, that gets your attention.
Yeah.
Yep. Announcements we have, we continue, haven't heard any more from Koji about what the needs are at the Women's Center, but we will be talking with them and we will find out. And let you know, because we want to continue to participate in that project with them. Bible study today's at 1:30. The laughter activities continue on Monday evenings. We have a community service event at Aldi's in Wexford on Saturday, next Saturday. Do we have a time for that, Rachel?
Yes, I will call everybody with that tomorrow.
So you will let people know.
Yes.
The time.
Yes.
Okay. We continue to take up our One Great Hour of Sharing offering. As you know, that's one of the quarterly offerings that our denomination takes up. And we have information that they have already given some money to the relief efforts in Oklahoma, where they had the tornadoes recently. So this is, you know, you see a lot of different requests for help for people in need, and often we say, well, we're not sure how much of that gets to the people, and are these people a legitimate charity or not. And actually, because some of the charities have they end up spending 75% of what they get on their fundraising efforts, et cetera, et cetera, and like only 20-25% actually goes for whatever the charity is that they're supposedly supporting. So, however, when you give to our quarterly offerings, you know that is going to get exactly what it's asked for, that's what it's used for, and 95% of what's given goes actually to the people or to the projects that you're giving money to. The denomination picks up any administrative expenses beyond 5%. So that's why we push it, because we think it's offering that of helping other people in different kind of situations. Each of our quarterly offerings, where you know that it's going to go and be used for what you want it used for. So. If you will, we've yet through the month of June, we'll be taking up this offering. Look at your giving plans, and if you will, put something in the envelope. The other envelope in your bulletin is offering that goes to this church's budget. And, we don't often talk about money and giving here, because we generally have generous givers. However, we are at a point where we're having to draw into our reserves in order to make the budget balance, if you will. And so we would ask that you would consider whether or not you can add a little more in the plate over the next couple of months and see if we can't keep ourselves caught up. And the reason we have concern about drawing on our reserves is because we don't have very many reserves left. And God's always found a way to help us balance the budget. And we're, I guess, asking you folks to take part in that process. So if you would, look at your giving plans and see if you can add a little more in to the envelope for the church also over the next month or two. Our monthly work party will be Friday, June 21st from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And I believe our next council meeting, I didn't put it in here because I thought I'd written everything in my calendar, but I haven't. So I need to take another look.
On the calendar?
Yes, it is. I need to take another look. Well, I do these bulletins when I'm at home, so I need to take another look, make sure I've got everything from the calendar on our bulletin board also in my personal calendar. Yes, that's correct.
So we're
looking at
Sunday.
Okay. That's not the last. No, it
isn't. Even though it's a 30-day month, we
have five. Yeah, have five this week. Yes.
And just for our family getting together that many times in 1 year is like sheer miracle. So, yeah, it's totally not early.
Yeah.
At least anymore.
Okay. Well, keep us posted on that.
Okay.
All right. Very good. Any other announcements? There being none, and we shall begin our worship service. Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy steadfast love. According to thy abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned, and done that which is evil in thy sight, so that thou art justified in thy sentence, and blameless in thy judgment. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward being. Therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Fill me with joy and gladness. Let the bones which thou hast broken rejoice. Hide my faith, thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. As we consider the psalmist's words of how much he desires to have the right relationship with God, how much he recognizes what he's done to walk in a direction that is not in the direction God would have him go. Yet his recognition of God's love and of God's plan for forgiveness. And he then asked to be given wisdom, to be given the joy of salvation, to have a clean heart and a new and right spirit. As we consider those words, let us prepare our hearts for worship this morning, remembering those times indeed when we have gone astray, and yet turning back to him, seeking the forgiveness through his plan for redemption through the blood of his son Jesus, that by his life, death, and resurrection we can be restored to our relationship with God. Let us pray. O Lord God, we come before you this morning as we consider the psalmist's words, the words from the book that is indeed your word. We come and acknowledge the times when we have sinned. We acknowledge that it's been our doings and our choices. That we come, Lord, to seek the forgiveness that you always have ready for us, as often as we confess our sins and seek reconciliation with you. And we come, Lord, then with hearts open to your Holy Spirit, that we can worship and we can sing and pray and give offerings and hear from your word, that we can grow closer to you, that we can be strengthened in our faith journeys, that we can know the joy that only comes from relationship with you. And as we consider all the many things that you have done for us, the greatest, of course, is the gift of your Son, Jesus. Indeed, that by his life, his blood, his resurrection, we are set free. So we would pray the prayer together, the prayer that he taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our reading for this morning is number 472. It's called A Lamp and a Light. And it comes from Isaiah, Timothy, Hebrews, 2 Timothy, Hebrews, and Psalms. So it's a good cross-section of scripture here. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God stands forever. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
The word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul.
Statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart.
The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever.
The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous.
They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, than honey from the comb. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward.
Teach me the knowledge and good judgment, for I believe in your commands.
I am your servant. Give me discernment that I may understand your statutes.
Great peace have they who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. Praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches.
My heart is set on keeping your decrees to the very end.
Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law.
I meditate on your precepts.
I consider your ways.
I delight in your decrees. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. It is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Amen. May the Lord bless our reading of his word together. Our first musical selection is in the hymnal. It's number 526, The Solid Rock.
Fills how nothing.
Yeah, that's the one drawback to that one.
I like that song.
It's a good song.
It's a good one.
It's solid. I like the picture of the SUV in the ice. You know? And the kids wrapped on the ice, danger, thin ice. It's like, well, all right. So let's then continue our worship with our tithes and offerings. Thank you. Let's sing the doxology together. God, how much we do indeed just thank you and praise you for all that you have done for us. As we consider the good times and the difficult times, as we look back over the different things we've had to deal with in our lives, the more we focus on who you are, the more we see you at work in our lives. In the good times, to just the joy of your presence adds so much to the celebration and to the fun, to the connectedness that we have with loved ones and close friends. And we know that our connectedness to others is a reflection of that desire to be connected with you. And so we thank you for those times, for the difficult times when we've struggled. We realize when times that we've turned away from you that made it very difficult for you to work in our lives. And at times when we turned to you and you brought relief, you brought a way out that we would not have envisioned. You brought people and opportunities into our lives so that we could get back on track. And we now recognize that back on track was the track of our faith journey and our relationship with you. So we bring these gifts as a way of saying thank you, as a way of saying how much we desire to be part of building your kingdom, sharing the good news, and being able to have as many as possible also on the same path. So we ask you to bless both the giver and the gift. And for those unable to give, we know in their hearts giving is what they would like to do. And in their time, we know they will. So we ask blessings on them as well. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we now come to that part of our service that is in many ways the most important part, because we gather as members of the body of Christ to talk with God. And our talking with him is not telling him things he doesn't already know. It's an expression of our faith in him, expression of our belief that indeed he answers prayers, expression of our recognition that in the past his answered prayer has often been different and much better than what we may have envisioned. It's a time of just seeking his presence to hear what his Spirit has to say to us. It's a time of expressing our joy in recognizing him at work in our lives and how much we appreciate it. For we are called to praise him. We are called to recognize his God at work in our lives, just as we're called to bring the difficult situations to him also. And just as he has washed us clean when we brought our sins to the foot of the cross, so he will take care of those issues that we bring and lay before him. So, any folks have praise or situations which they would like special attention from God?
An acquaintance, friend of our son Doug, had some, his brother passed away from flu early last year, and sometime in the winter, his mother also had flu, and she was put on oxygen. Sometime during the winter, there was an explosion of her oxygen, probably because she was smoking, and it burned her up, and the house that the kid couldn't get, he's not a kid, he's 50 probably, he couldn't get his mother because that's where the explosion was. But he did get out of the house, but he lost everything. So he lost his brother, and he lost his mother and the house and everything. Our son was at a dinner helping, a fundraising dinner yesterday.
What's his first name?
I can't remember his name.
Doug's friend.
Doug's friend. Okay. Good enough. God will know which friend it is, I'm sure.
Yep.
He won't have to go, now, which one? Is that the one over that had trouble, or this one is having to? Which friend? I think God knows.
Yeah.
Okay.
And for that reason, we're celebrating his birthday today.
Ah.
Instead of yesterday,
which was his birthday. That was a good reason to, And so the family that's around here will be at our house this afternoon and celebrate the birthday.
That's very awesome. I would like to say, ask extra praise from God and thanks to God. I've had a lot of reflections this week. And one thing I really want to take extra time to thank God for sincerely, and it's in a situation that this person sometimes gets overlooked in your life, is my wonderful spouse, my wife. She is so truly wonderful and does so much, and truly, truly does so, so very much, and has so much faith in God that we are sharing together, and just she really is, I can't say enough on how much work she's putting in to life and trying her hardest to get ahead and doing everything through the proper channels and correctly. And I am just so grateful for her and thankful for her. Like I told her that she waited for me while I was sick for so long. And that means so much to me because I know I was a rotten person. I was being a rotten person for a while. I know I was. And she knew that wasn't me, that my body was being leaked.
actually, I would give that as a human witness to also how God waits for us to turn back to Him.
Absolutely.
And it's His love that He has that patience. I think we often don't, when people talk about God giving us gifts, we think often in terms of talents and abilities and things like that, and we don't fully recognize that some of the gifts that God gives us is the people in our lives and the opportunities for things that other people create. Like, you'll have some people say, I made it all on my own, nobody ever helped me. And I go, I think somebody helped you to become potty trained, to learn how to dress yourself, to learn how to read and write, to learn how to interact with people, to if you played ball or you're a member of the band or something, learn a little bit about teamwork. And you know this good job you have right now? The person who hired you didn't have to hire you. They could have chosen somebody else. I'll guarantee you they had other people applying for that job. So a lot of times we want to say too much of what we've done. We don't recognize that it's the opportunities and the people that God puts in our lives that is a gift. And as you're saying, when you fully begin to more fully realize who some of those people are, it's like hopefully gratitude is overwhelming gratitude is to that person and to God for giving me that person in my life. Yep. And actually, when we were in Florida last, and they were kind of in a weekend revival activities in our daughter's church, and the guy who was the speaker for the weekend, he talked about honoring the people in your lives and the opportunities, and that we often don't realize how many people have really acted on our behalf. And I had the privilege of speaking the next Sunday, and actually a fair amount of what there were several different speakers, what they said kind of fell in line. I kind of summarized some of that in my message. And I wanted to publicly honor the people who had been there for me in so many ways. And once you start, you begin to have a list that says, I could speak for 2 hours on these people who have done these things for me. And it is so overwhelming when we see that it's all a manifestation of God's love, and we experience it through these people who are special to us. So you've been a conduit for God's love and compassion and patience and forgiveness. So our gratitude there is that you've been a willing conduit for Him. I mean, I'm overwhelmed when I see people say, oh, you helped me this and that, and I'm going, no, it was God working through me. And so it is very special. Okay?
So I have just thankfulness in general. We've been, you know, really making a lot of progress in different areas. And it's, you know, it's wonderful to be able to thank God, you know, every day and wake up with Him in our hearts and in our minds. And I was telling Mark, you know, the past couple of days I've woken up with, you know, a Caleb song in my head. And you know, that's rather unusual for me. And I've really been enjoying it. And Mark commented, you know, yeah, I woke up happy this morning too. You know, that doesn't usually happen with him and with his medication. But along the lines of the small praises, the small gifts, the things that we're wearing today, we have to throw an extra praise out for that. We stopped over with his parents and don't usually get to interact with his nephews. And they were both there, and they both had these new things called rainbow balloons.
Mm-hmm.
And they made us these bracelets, and they were just precious, absolutely precious.
Lots of love and pride.
Yes.
Lots of love and
pride. Had them on for the whole week.
I woke up. It was a gift. We don't get to spend much time with my nephews. And that's why I'm proudly wearing these. A lot of love and pride and individuals for my nephews.
I woke up and all I was thinking about was on.
That's
not
that.
That's not really a great thing. That's me. Passing 10th grade.
There you go.
Hey.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you had a few extra obstacles this year. So it is. Yes, sir. Okay, anything else? Okay, let's go before the Lord then. Lord God, we come before you today. We come as just part of our desire, part of the process, part of our recognizing the direction we need to be walking each day. To be able to have that close relationship with you. We come that we can each day experience the joy and the strength and the peace of being in your presence, in part because of how much it means to us in strengthening us in dealing with the difficulties in this life, and in part because when we're in your presence, we experience at least some of what life will be like with you when we are fully in your kingdom. And so we come, Lord, because we desire to grow in our relationship with you. We come because we desire to so grow in that relationship that we will be more than ready to enter your kingdom when that time comes. And Lord God, we come also that we can carry you with us out in the world, that we can be a witness to others of who you are through what you've done for us. Not, Lord, so people will think that we're such wonderful, righteous people. but so that more would be touched by your Holy Spirit. So that more people would desire to be on that same journey with us. For we know our relationship with you is not complete unless it's in conjunction with the rest of the body of Christ. And so, Lord, we come to you. We seek your face. We seek your presence. We seek the strength and the opportunities to walk with you each day. We seek to better understand your word. We seek to better understand how we carry out your word in a very difficult world. And so, with hearts open to you, Lord, we acknowledge you also as our creator, our sustainer and provider, our guide and our teacher, the one who is always there for us. The one who heals, the one who strengthens, the one who comforts, the one who enlightens, and the one who has redeemed us for himself. And in so doing, Lord, we know we can bring before you our concerns, our fears, our times of pain and difficulty, as well as the joy and the praises of your work in our lives, of your Holy Spirit who lives within us, as often as our hearts are open for that to happen. So, Lord, we especially pray for Doug's friend. The losses, the difficulties, not just of one tragic loss, but three in a year's time. Lord, we pray that you will strengthen him and comfort him. We pray that you will bring him people into his lives who will give him a sense of still being worthwhile, a sense of being needed. That in spite of the tragedies, that there is still hope. That in spite of the difficulties, there will be things in his life that are meaningful to him and to others. That what he does can make a difference yet in other people's lives. That you will bring him some opportunities for joy and humor. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will be with him, that he can work through that grieving process and complete it as a whole person, and complete it in a way that he's even closer with you. And Lord God, indeed, how our hearts go out for all those who suffer similar kinds of tragedies. It's in the news all over the place. And there's so many hurting people. We pray too for those who are lost from you. And our hearts go out to them as well. For they don't have that solid rock they can stand on. They don't have a place of refuge. They don't have an anchor point for their lives. And indeed, Lord, as we take a step back and look at this world, all else indeed is shifting sand. And so, Lord, there's so much that needs to be different. We need leaders who have the backbone to stand up and do what is right. And not just political leaders, but leaders of businesses and agencies and volunteer organizations and churches. And so, Lord, we ask your strength that we can have the backbone, at least in our lives and our witnesses, to stand up and do what is right. Lord, we also have many things in our lives that brings joy. The opportunity to gather and to celebrate special activities, special events, of which birthdays are always that. For we celebrate how glad we are that that person was born, not just born, but born in a situation that they are part of our lives. And we thank you too, and we can just get together just to enjoy being together. When we can be with families and there's positive interactions, support for one another, and being able to enjoy those in our extended family, nieces and nephews and cousins. For it all speaks to the connectedness that we have with other people in a very special way. It also reinforces for us that this is what it's like to be in a family where things are positive and where love and support are parcel of the relationships. How much more glorious even it's going to be when, as part of your family, we celebrate together in your kingdom. Also, Lord, we so much appreciate the people in our lives who have patience with us as we work through whatever we have to work through, who have patience not just this time, but time and again and again and again. For not only does that help us when we finally see the light, it's a witness to us of the kind of patience you have. And as we expand our view, we realize that the patience you've had with human beings for thousands of years, and how much we appreciate the people that stand by us, the people that love us even when we're being jerks. And the people who are there to share their happiness when we finally see the light and get on the right direction. And Lord, we know also that in this, our society, the health and mental health systems and the legal systems, the education systems, how much they're broken. And how special it is when we have teachers that really help us. When we have medical and mental health professionals who do what's right with us in healing in the body and mind. In our spiritual leaders, a healing in our spirits. We thank you so much for all that that's out there. We thank you for the healing that you've built into us if we only get ourselves going in the right direction. And so here today, Lord, we're thankful for Rachel and who she is, how much she's done for her family, what she's doing in this congregation to have activities that will be good for others in the community who might be hurting. And how thankful we are that Mark has finally seen the light. In so doing, his natural healing is taking over, and that he is able to appreciate so much in his life, how good it is to see who he really is. And we thank you for him as well. Lord God, we also pray for this church. Our desire, as you know, is first to serve you and give you the glory. Our desire is to have enough people and income that we can provide services that are helpful to hurting people in the community, that we can be a way of a conduit for your Holy Spirit to work. And so we look forward to having people join us for whom these two chairs next to me are empty and waiting. Indeed, Lord, we would ask to be surprised with enough people here to have 25 here in one Sunday. And pray you'll give us the ability to manage that much of a change in accordance with your plan. These many things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Got the music run. Wait a minute, we have another song here. I'm sorry.
Yes, and I love that song. You've got to put that in there.
Okay. Our next song is not in the hymnal. I'd like the one so much that we did with Mercy Me 2 weeks ago that I thought we might listen to them again this morning. You can turn this up just a little, Ron.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Myself
Just wondering if you folks have seen on anywhere on the news that there was a young man and he's to give his, I guess he was a valedictorian, he was to give his graduation speech. And he had I guess, submitted to the school for approval. And when he got up to speak, he tore it up and said the Lord's Prayer instead. And actually, that was extremely well received by those who were in attendance.
Apparently, there were 100 people that were like, "You're older than my group."
Yeah.
It's like, excuse
me, everywhere.
Everywhere. Time and place.
Well, you read the scriptures. Paul says, "Every time, in all times and all places, be involved in prayer." So, anyway, there's a part of what I had prepared that, and I don't know, you know, some of you folks may have found when you ask God for inspiration, sort of sometimes it comes when you aren't quite expecting it. And so this morning in my prayers, I'm waking up just ask God for inspiration for today, just in terms of being able to deliver the message. And when it comes to truth, there was, not that I didn't know this kind of back of my head, but he kind of revealed this. It said, you need to say this morning. So I will work that in to what I already have prepared when we're talking about the truth. And indeed, we are returning today to finish up our look at the truth in scriptures. As always, we know that no matter how much we may say, either in Bible study or from the pulpit on a Sunday morning or Sunday school, that there's always more to say than what we can put together in that time. So this is a perspective on things. It's not the end all and be all of the truth in the scriptures. So last Sunday we learned that we're to follow the way of truth and light, the way that brings true life to our existence, and the way that's clearly laid out in the scriptures. And we're going to touch on that clarity later on. That's part of the inspiration. We also learn that God's truth is clear and never changing, including his plan for us if we only decide to reach for and to follow him. Also, that the central part of the plan is God's redemption is always there for us. So we found that his truth provides guidance, protection, peace, understanding, and redemption into eternal life in his kingdom. and that the world leads in a quite different direction, even though Satan tries to cover that truth by lies and deception. And you know, I was going to add later on, but I'm going to add it now. And actually, part of the truth is, God wants us. God wants us to be in His kingdom. He wants us in His kingdom, be in His kingdom, because that's what He created us for. He wants us to be in His kingdom because He desires to be in relationship with us. That's the truth. The truth is not what the world will have you think is the truth. Because Satan doesn't want you for him, for his kingdom, because Satan doesn't have a kingdom. Hell is not a kingdom. Hell is a place of fire and brimstone and suffering, period. It's not a kingdom. The only reason Satan wants you is so God, because he doesn't want God to have you. Satan wants you for selfish reasons. Satan wants you to die spiritually. And when you were all messed up, would you say you were half dead? His Spirit's given you life, some of which came through you. That was the truth that came to me this morning. The truth is, God wants you for His kingdom. God wants you so you can have eternal life with Him. God, that's the truth. That's why God wants you. That's why He does everything that He does for you. And the truth is, Satan doesn't want you. He just wants God to not have you. Does that put a little perspective on where the world's going? Does that put a little perspective on all the lies that Satan puts through? I mean, talk about truth versus lies. All the lies that Satan puts through the worldly things to pull you away from that. How much he deceives people. You know, I sometimes in when there are news articles on my homepage about things that I know people are going to have some comment about, it's particularly anything that deals with science. Science versus religion. And the totally false ideas people had of who God is. Refer to Him as some sky fairy. Refer to Jesus Christ as a zombie on a stick. Talk about lies. Talk about the difference between what's truth and what isn't. These folks don't even know, but they think they know. That's part of the lie. And folks, we can't do what Adam did. Because it didn't work then, it's not going to work now. We can't say, well, Satan deceived me, God. We can get before the judgment seat. Satan deceived me, God. You know, I didn't know. And God's going to go, I heard that in the Garden of Eden. Well, God, the woman fooled me. She had me. I didn't know. Well, you're supposed to know. It's been there for you all the time. I've given you my word and told you what to do. That's another lie. God is so compassionate. He just understands that Satan deceived you, so he's going to go, well, okay, then. No. So we found that His truth provides guidance, protection, peace, understanding, and redemption into eternal life in His kingdom. And that the world leads, or Satan leads, in a quite different direction. Even though Satan tries to cover that truth by lies and deception. His lie is what it was from the beginning. You can be like God. You'll have the knowledge of good and evil, and you'll be like God. And God just doesn't want you to be like Him. That's the lie. It's been the same lie ever since day one that has sounded true. We also learn that scriptures talk about Christ as a truth. Even Jesus himself said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And again in John 8:58, I tell you the truth, Jesus answered, before Abraham was born, I am. Also, you may remember that although English does not have a form of the word truth that we can use as a verb, the Greek language does, which means at times Paul was actually talking about whether or not we are, if you will, truthing in our lives. In other words, are you living a lie or are you living the truth? We can be truthing or we can be lying in what we're doing. So I would also think that when we have experienced integrity in others, particularly in a person of faith, and then when we have tried to act with integrity of our lives, they were, and we are, in fact, truthing in our lives. So today we're going to look a little more at the New Testament perspective on truth, hearing from Jesus and Paul about the subject, and find that there's much truth, or that there is much that truth, or if you will, truthing, does for our faith and for our lives as we are doing this on a regular basis. Now, when we notice that Jesus is the truth and the truth is Jesus, and therefore, given you may remember what we learned about the attributes of God, this means, and one of those attributes that is here is a God in being three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They're all equal in who they are. They're all part of the Godhead. They're all equal. They are all equally God. Some people want to make it sound like, well, the Holy Spirit is this servant that God sends out. This servant that you can't see sends out. No, the Holy Spirit is just as much God as is God the Father. And actually, they're just different parts of who God is that takes care of all the different things that God has to take care of. Sort of God had diversity worked out long before human beings ever thought of it as something that's politically correct to do. So that means then that the Holy Spirit, that the attributes of God, then if Jesus is the truth, therefore the Holy Spirit's also the truth. And he's the truth who works for us and in us as part of God's plan. There are several things that the Spirit does that confirms the truth. First of which is to be the power, part of the power of being born again. In reply, John 3:3, this was in reply to Nicodemus. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born again. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. So the Spirit confirms the truth because he is the truth. The Spirit also testifies to us, as in John 15:26, when the Counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And in 1 John 5:6, and it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. So when the Holy Spirit is operating in you, then you're probably truthing, because that's what he's all about. The Holy Spirit is one of action. In addition, the Spirit is part of our worshiping and being freed from sin, thereby being true to God, as in John 4:23-24. Yet a time is coming, and now has come, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. And if you think a part of the truth is that God wants us for his kingdom, as opposed to Satan wanting us to deny us from that, that's the only reason he wants it. That if we worship in spirit and truth, we're worshiping in the spirit of saying, I'm going to go along with what God wants. I want to develop that. I want to have that be strengthened. One reason we say every time we come together, we're coming together to strengthen us on our faith journeys. So we're worshiping in truth. In John 8:31-34, to the Jews who believed him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. So the truth sets you free. The Holy Spirit sets you free. God sets you free. The truth sets you free because you know I'm not going to follow Satan because I know what Satan's all about. So that sets me free from that. I can see it. I can see the plot. I can see the plan. It's laid out in God's word, right and left, what Satan's plan is. I can see it. So the truth sets me free from the bondage of sin and sets me free from damnation. I'm no longer a slave to sin. I may still sin at times because I'm not perfect, but I'm not a slave to sin. And we all know times in our lives when we may have been. We've certainly known other people who have been, and how difficult it is to get them to see the truth. As you were talking, Mark, about having many reflections this week, my crazy mind runs through, well, stop looking in so many mirrors. But, you know, when you do, you go, look what I was a slave to. We all do that. We look at it and we go, but no more. And now if I look and see myself, I've got the truth, so I'm going to stop doing that. That's not God in me when I see that. So the truth is brought to us by the Spirit, testifies to Jesus and to the truth about Jesus. The truth that by our belief in Him and the work of redemption that Jesus has done, then we will be set free from anything the world might have that would bind us from God and His kingdom. That's the truth. You're no longer bound to anything of the world. The truth then that sets us free was again noticed in John 5:24. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. The truth is the Holy Spirit gives you life. Jesus' life, death, and resurrection gives you life. From death to life, from God through his Son, hearing and worshiping in spirit and the truth, and we have crossed from death to life. It's not just better life on this earth. It's life eternal. What is Satan's lie going to give you? Hopefully, as you hear it, it's going to give you a better life on this earth. But that's it. After that, you're going to be in the lake of fire. God gives you a better life that is eternal. Satan doesn't tell you that. This is not wishy-washy. This is something, if you think about it, so overwhelming, you have to think about it, not just nod our heads and say the words. The question is, are you fully embracing it in your hearts? That's why the fullness is not attained just by agreement. It requires embracing. Have you ever had anybody agree with you and then go out and do the opposite? What was in their heart? It certainly was. They certainly didn't embrace what they nodded their head in agreement to. So this fullness of what's being offered here, it is so overwhelming, you can't just say okay and then go on about your business. You know, this thing of relationship with God, it's not like an insurance policy. You know, you can sign an insurance policy and then go be involved in whatever you want to be involved in that can be as dangerous as possible. I've had people say, I go to church, it's an insurance policy. So when I get up before the judgment seat, I can say, well, I went to church regularly. In fact, I work with the guy who used to hold out his being this righteous Christian, kind of remind you of a Pharisee. People wanted to challenge whether or not he was Christian, this and that. Well, he had this pin for like 15 years attendance of Sunday school, never missed a Sunday. He'd actually hold that out to you and go, what do you mean I'm not Christian? Look at this. So when he finally saw the light, it was like Paul Paul on the Damascus Road. You know, it's like, and then what did Paul say? Everything I've gotten in my past, all that I've earned, all that I've acquired, all the recognition, Paul was on track, a lot of people think, to becoming the chief priest in the temple. What did he say that was? It's all trash. compared to the riches God has for me in heaven, it's all trash. So embrace this truth, folks. The difference between a better life on earth and life eternal. And I think those who say, I choose life eternal, find that life on this earth also goes a lot better. So with God, you get both. A little more subtle of how it's going to happen, but you get both. Satan, you only get one. The truth is also desired by the kind of love that God has for us and that we are to have for one another and for the lost world. We certainly remember parts of 1 Corinthians 13 in which Paul describes the different aspects of love, which helps us understand this love, even as the magnitude of God's love can still be beyond our grasp to totally understand. And that's why there's that song that says, God, I'm such a sinner. What did you love about me that you wanted to... What did you think was worth saving? We don't understand that depth. We can experience bits and pieces of it. You have. We don't understand that depth. Note particularly in 1 Corinthians 13, 6, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. So evil is opposite of the truth. Ephesians 5, 8 to 10, for once you were in darkness, but now you are in light in the Lord. Live as children of the light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. So truth is also part of the love that God has for us and the fruit of the light that his love brings to us. Further, the truth is also an active part of God's grace in purifying us and sanctifying us as we move along in our faith journeys, as we seek to be able to stand in God's presence in this life and live in his presence in the next. Perhaps here too we can think of truth as a verb, a way of acting and being. In other words, truthing is part of both the fruit of the light and the sanctifying and purifying process. Note in 2 Thessalonians 2:13, from the beginning, God chose you to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the
truth.
Amen. Belief in the truth. It's also in Jesus' prayer to God for his disciples in John 17:17. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is
truth.
In 1 Peter 1:22, now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so you have sincere love for your brothers, love one another deeply from the heart. You see how this truth is also tied up with love? See where we're going with this? Because part of the truth is God's love. Part of the truth is love. Part of the truth of whether or not I care about somebody is the love that I have for them. And lastly, an admonition as well as a specific direction for us to consider. As always, there's something that tells us what happens if we do not do as noted above, as in Romans 2:8. But those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil. Once again, truth, evil. You reject the truth, there's no middle ground. You reject the truth, you're following evil. There will be wrath and anger, and he's talking about at the end. In a specific direction to the contrary, in 1 Timothy 3:8, they, that is deacons and church leaders, must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. So there's a lot to be considered here as we think about what we covered in our first message and on truth and on this one. We can see that God has given us clear guidance of both what we are to be doing as his people, as those who have embraced the redemption he so freely prophesied and provided, and as those who are in the process of sanctification. His word is truth, his spirit is truth, his son is truth, and it is in grasping the truth of all these things of faith, It's in recognizing the fullness of the truth about God and His patience, His creativity, His relationship, His desire for relationships, His power, His love, His grace, His glory, His majesty, His justice, His mercy. It's with all these that we then come to a position of full faith, trust, and obedience to Him. Think about this. The more you know the truth, the more you know whether or not you can trust somebody, whether or not you can trust this situation, whether or not we know, I mean, one of the truths of the laws that God has given in the universe is you jump off the roof, you're going to fall. If we know that, we can keep ourselves safe. I don't think I'm going to jump off the roof today. I don't think I want to be hurt. The more we know, the more we recognize God wants us for His kingdom, Satan wants to deny us of the kingdom. The more we recognize that everything in God's word is true. Now, not necessarily sentence by sentence, folks. We have to put it in context. We have to understand that we've talked about that before. Recognizing fully who God is. Then we can become to a position full of faith, trust, and obedience to Him. Truth is, He has kept every promise He's ever made that needed to be fulfilled between when the promise was made and now. That's truth. Can you trust somebody who always keeps their promises? I think so. If you know somebody always tells you what's real about something, then are you willing to go along with them? I think so. And that's the truth. This realization, this commitment of this seeing the reality of our situation, including the daily choices we make, to either walk with Him or walk with the world, to be, if you will, either truthing or lying, the truth condemned, that the two cannot be condemned. It's either or, it's not both and. You know anybody who seems to think, well, I can lie, both lie and be a good person? I bet you know at least one person like that. Or I can tell the truth, but then I can go over here and do things that are negative or hurtful. It's like, what? It's either or, folks. So this realization, this commitment that God has to us and that we're able to make to Him, this seeing the reality of our situations, that it's either or, it's not both and, this then opens the door for us to be set free from the bondage to sin and into the grace that God provides to be able to be bound to Him instead. And it just struck me here, you know, I think it was the Greek philosopher Plato. He said, after studying all different kinds of government, he says the best kind is a government with a benevolent despot. He has the power to make everything happen, and he wants to make it happen for you, for his people. Well, you know what? We have the ultimate benevolent despot in God. So if we're going to be bound to Him, that's a lot better than being bound to the sin that the world offers. You may remember when we talked about the armor of God in Ephesians 6:14, it talks about the loin belt of truth that is a foundation for the rest of the armor of God. That belt was big, tough, strong. It could support all the armor, all the weaponry, everything that the soldier carried. And the armor that Paul was talking about, I mean, he actually put that symbolism as from the armor, the Roman armor that he saw that everybody there knew. Most of them hated it, but they knew it. And as long as the Roman soldiers wore that kind of armor, it was almost impenetrable to kill a Roman soldier because of the quality and the strength and the heaviness of that armor. And it was probably well over 100 pounds. And so they had to train with that. You know from the military, sometimes you carry that pack over 100 pounds and everything. And you have to train with that to get good at it, to be tough enough to go into battle and deal with it. That's what the Roman soldiers did all the time. Well, they got very successful. And then they said, we're tired of having to work so hard. And they got armor that was lighter and lighter and not as difficult to train with. And guess what? That's when the Roman army started to suffer defeats. So what was the basis of the armor that protected them and kept them alive? The loin belt of truth. So the truth is what your faith, what all the other armor God can give you, that is the base of it. That's where you get the strength of it. This is the truth we're talking about. If we're strong in the truth, then indeed none of Satan's lies will work to get us off track. Or even those times when we are leaning towards believing one of his lies, we will be quick to realize it and get back on track when a brother or sister in Christ confronts us on the reality of our thinking. I should have asked here too, that or said here too, when I'm hearing something on the radio, I'm reading scripture, or different things that can jog me into saying I'm getting off track. Hopefully we don't have such a conflictual relationship with our spouse that if our spouse confronts us, we go, you know, you're right. So the truth is that God's done all the work. All we have to do is cooperate with his plan and do our part to carry it out. The truth is we can discern our part by what the instruction manual, it's called the Bible, tells us what to do. The truth is that God loves us enough to give us all the understanding, grace, and strength we need to withstand all of Satan's lies and plots. The truth is that to live for him is life more glorious than anything the world can give, and will be a life more glorious in his kingdom than anything we can only partly imagine. The truth is that by truthing in our lives, we will move along in our faith journeys to sanctification, purification, and ultimately to be joined with one another in his kingdom. I look forward to seeing every one of you in his kingdom. That's the end thing of what we're doing. I'd like to see everybody out there in his kingdom. That's the end thing of what we're doing. And the truth gives us the foundation to be able to make the choices that indeed that will happen. So that's where this whole thing about faith, people say, well, you have faith in nothing. No, I have faith in things that there are a lot of physical and scientific things that prove it and point to it. What I don't see that I have faith in is that God, in all of his magnificent glory, is not standing there in a doorway. If he was, probably our brains would all be fried because our neurological system couldn't stand it. Faith is on the truth. Truth is the tomb was empty on Resurrection Sunday. There's no evidence that it wasn't. There's no doubt by any of the contemporaries that the tomb was empty. The truth is that by truthing in our lives, we will move along in our faith journeys to sanctification, purification, and ultimately to be joined with one another in his kingdom. Indeed, I greatly look forward to meeting all of you there, not because of anything great I've done, but because of what he has already done for me and for you. And all we have to do is make the choice to follow the path that he has laid out for us. Glory to God, it couldn't get any better than that. Let us pray. Oh Lord, how wonderful is the truth that you have given to us in your word, in your Son, in your Holy Spirit. We pray our hearts will be always open to hear, discern, and practice the truths that you have taught us, which you have bestowed upon us. Lord God, keep us always close to you. Empower us to daily walk with you in truth, and strengthen us on our faith journeys to sanctification, purification, and ultimately to your kingdom. As we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Thoughts, comments, questions? Yes.
One thing, you said that if you had Satan, things would be okay in this world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How many times have people gotten huge amounts of money,
mm-hmm,
and be in a hotel room and say, is this all it is?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How many people have won the lottery and 2 years later, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars, they have nothing to show for it. They're almost poorer than they started out. Mm-hmm. It blows my mind. I don't understand.
Yeah, but the a really, really great actor was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Another was a ball player.
Mm-hmm. It ends up being empty.
It was empty.
There's a very good movie. It's called There Will Be Blood. Daniel Day-Lewis stars in it. And he's about a guy at the turn of the century that was all about developing oil wells. And how he seems to be oriented towards being a success with it, but he seems to be treat other people decently. But then as things move along, it ends up where he has his big mansion and he's estranged from his son. I mean, there are like a couple of bowling alleys in on the ground floor in a basement of the mansion. And he has nobody there. And there's a guy that he tried to expose as a false preacher that he, in his anger, he had killed on his bowling alley. And he's sitting there, and like there's nothing. I think even his main servant had left him. And he's sitting there with all this opulence, and he has nothing. And even the guy who would try to bring God to him, he had killed him. And it was just, I mean, you just go, wow. And so people can have an awful lot, but that. At some point, an awful lot of those folks realize is that all there is. Peggy Lee sang a song like that.
Yeah.
You know, try this, try that. Is that all? Well, if that's all there is, then break out the booze and keep on dancing. It's like, and that's your answer?
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's.
So that was my only comment. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, he needs God so badly. You know, the whole system.
Well, if you look at the truth of things, you realize it.
Yeah.
And if you're not, and I was just thinking too, all of our worldly leaders promise us stuff they can't deliver. Satan promises that which he can't deliver. He promised us happiness in this life.
Mark and I were talking about that this last night, how if you look at all promises and you look at everything that we have and, you know, this, that, and the other thing, and you chunk it into what was and what is now, it's like you've been grounded in this lump since we've walked away from having God in our lives and our traditions and our, you know,
schools.
Yeah, and you can just go, no, I don't like all of this, you know.
Yeah.
You know, you can chuck it and go back to 1920, but, you know, it's like, what happened? Why? Why did we start doing that? Why?
Well, it was a slow process, similar to change like that comes in the same way that kids will get their parents to let them to do stuff. I go, well, you know, this is your rule, but you know, this right here really isn't fair. And, you know, if you're going to be fair, you need to do this, which just takes me one step off of where I would have it be. And because we always want to be fair. See, that's sort of the magic word. We're going to be fair, then we need to do this. And then the next time they want something, they don't compare it to the direction you were going, and they compare it to the direction you compromised. It's only one step different from that. Only one step different from that. How can it be that bad? And really, it's even fairer than the other thing. And it isn't until we're way over here and hit a stone wall of some kind, or something really big happens. How did we get here? You know, because if you're going this way and somebody says, you know what, let's do that over there, you'd say no. It's the same thing that I'm sure if Josh was out with friends and some of them said, let's go steal cars, he'd say no. Yet there could be small steps that could lead into that. See, that's why you don't want to hang out with people who even think it's okay to go steal cars, even if you're not going to, because after a while you'll start doing what they do, and it's little steps. And all of a sudden you find yourself riding in that stolen car with them. And yep. Yep. That's, it's like I have to stay away from this.
And,
yep. And the truth in here says don't hang out with people like that. It doesn't say hate them. It doesn't say mistreat them. It doesn't say go pick fights with them. It doesn't say go shoot them. It just says don't hang out with them. Hopefully, our witness, there's going to be some that are going to say, well, how come you do that? And we say why we do it, and they go, some are going to say, well, I'd like that too. See, it's actually our witness to say no. I mean, look at the recovery groups. What else? People stay in recovery. It's people helping people stay and say, don't go to those people, places, things. Don't hang out with them. Don't be doing that any longer. And you got people that help strengthen you going, that's why you come to church. You know, I mean, you go to the grocery store at least once a week and you every day serve up food. Well, where are you going to get your spiritual food? You can get some from reading at home and your own Bible study and that. You get a lot. You get a smorgasbord when you come to church.
Well, I said to Josh this morning, I would ask us that Sunday is to keep the Sabbath holy.
Yeah.
And that's because it said that is so I can show you and remind you how much I love him.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons that you honor that day.
Well,
it's for you, but it's, you know, you're honoring me and it's to remind you of how much I love you. You know what I mean? Like,
and
it's not just a one-way thing.
And that helps keep us on the right path.
Yeah.
Because we get nourished.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so it's really the you know, just the fact Satan will make it sound like we can have a lot in this life and we'll be satisfied. And part of that difference in satisfying is because that way of dealing with things, we get excited over new things. But how long do you have to have something before it's no longer new? And then you're no longer excited about it. Yes, sir?
I think I just found something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he said unto them, I beheld what Satan as lightning fall from heaven. In the more Hebrew translation, it's more, I saw Satan come as lightning from the sky. In Hebrew, now I might, this might just be a pretty coincidence, but at the same time.
Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Bama is sky or heavens. O is from. Say the whole thing.
Lightning from heaven.
Barack Obama.
Isn't that interesting?
I am not kidding you.
Well,
this is crazy.
If you look at the direction our whole political system is taking us, where is it taking us?
So what is the Antichrist?
Yep. Yep.
Cool. I just discovered our presidency and Antichrist.
Very good.
That is marvelous.
Okay, let's have our final musical selection. It's Above All is the name of it.
Above all, kings above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began, and of all kingdoms, above all thrones,
now may he who has indeed thought of us above all, he who is above all, he who has given us truth beyond what we could imagine, as your hearts are open to him, may his Spirit go forth with you to continue to reinforce the strength of the truth in your lives. Amen.